You that have listened to my last episode know that I got the call. It was ringing, so I have to stop recording. I apologize for that, but I was in the end of talking, end of the episode, so I didn't break anything, but I couldn't say bye to you, so, but it was interesting what's happened after the last time I recording, and this is August 14, 2021, and I live in Sweden, and my name is Eva, and I am 68 years old, but I'm a modern person. I don't feel like I am 68, I feel more like 35, like that. What happened was that call, you heard the ringing. It was a woman that say that she have called a wrong number, and she was a little. She stopped when she like what she was saying, because she wanted me to tell her my name, but I always say only Eva. I never say my last name because it's a rare last name I have, so it's easy to find me. And I have been in that situation that I have had a stalker when I was young, when we have telephone books, and he look up my name and he called me the whole time. And I know it's important to not say the full name of you when you, especially today, what's going on in this world today, to not say more than your first name. And so when they call me from the doctor, they always ask, is this, and then they say my full name, and I say yes it is, so they have to know my name. But that woman, I was not thinking anything about it. But it was very strange because I don't get any telephone calls. Maybe I get a telephone call once every third month, like that. And that is from the hospital most of the time. Next day after that she called, I got on my phone, I got a message that I have order vaccination for COVID-19. It says we want to confirm that you have order apply for vaccination, and it was September 1st I should come and do the vaccine, and I was first I was thinking that it can't be, because I have only about 10 minutes to a place where I can get vaccination if I want. And this, what they say, I should come to a place that is about, I have to take a taxi, this for disabled taxis, and it's about 1 hour drive to that city. So it's not even in my city. So I was thinking it's something fishy here. If it's, I was thinking first that it's my son that have done something, because he live in that city where I should go and get my vaccine. So first I was thinking it was he, but then it was a link on in the message, and I don't use my telephone like other people do, like a computer. I have a laptop, so I go and look at it in my laptop instead, and look at that link, and where when I click on the link and click on where I should go, it was like a profile, my own profile was made there, and it should be, I don't know, because I didn't go there, but because the link took me to a bank ID. I should write down my birthday number, my ID number for myself, and then I should open my telephone and do the bank ID code on that website, and that was very fishy. So I called the police and told them about it, and I think that woman that called me wrong, I think she wanted to confirm that it was me, that because I should get that message on my telephone, so she wanted to know if it was me that have that telephone number. So she'd be confused when I didn't say my last name. And but they took the risk to send me that link. And I said to the police, they didn't know where they send the link, because I have work computer most of my life. So I know this about computer, internet, and these things, I say. So the police was worried that I had click on the link, but I say I don't click on the link on my telephone, because it's open very much there in the telephone, if they can hack into a telephone. So it's more safe to be on the laptop and do. But I never went in there. And they think it was very strange. The police was very strange that, and she said the police that it's very fishy when they want you to write down your ID, both your personal ID and also go in with your telephone, with your ID. I have my bank ID on my telephone. So that's what the police say. It's because of this with the ID things that they thought it was very fishy. And then when I have talked to the police, I investigate a little more about this website, and it's a little scaring what's going on today, because they have a doctor, a trust doctor in this clinic, and he was from Iran, was a Muslim man, and I have talked to you in another episode that terror will come with the health things, with doctors, hospitals, medicine. That's where the terror will come from, the Muslim side, for us in Western world. It was very scaring, because this man had not been so long time in Sweden. He grew up in Norway, but he was from Iran, and then when he come to Sweden, he go into a political party, so he infiltrate him into the political system, and then to my surprise, I read that he was involved in the police, and then he do the research, his science and research on crimes, this about violence against women, rape, these things. That means that he can, here in Sweden is it like this, that he can open up all the documents, everything, the whole ID on every person here in Sweden. He can go in and see everything. When he's in the police, when he's in science, and then he can't walk in as a political person, but he can listen and know what's going on when in the political system in Sweden. So I saw when I checked this doctor, the clinic head, that he have for a short time been infiltrated in the whole society system here in Sweden. And I think that the police will see it also, that is very strange. First, they maybe think that this man is an important man in the society, and he have been with us, the police, these things that they're gonna see. But if they are a little smart, they see that so much he have been involved in. And you know that there is doctors, there is people in the society that they buy their own certificate. There is doctors here in Sweden that have not been in not one lesson into the doctor school. They have bought all these papers and made them by themselves also. And maybe he have checked out me that I do these things that have been with God to do, and he think that I am a Christian person, so he want to take me. And but it's not that kind of thing, because I have no religion. But in the same time, when you say you have no religion, that means that if you don't believe in Islam, you are the enemy of Islam, whatever you believe in or not believe in. As long as you don't believe in Islam, then you are the enemy. And in this time now, you know, it's in Kabul, there the Talibans are taking over Kabul in Afghanistan, and it's a waste of money, waste of life, waste of, so many have died when they have been to Afghanistan to fight for the freedom for the people, and now suddenly they disappear. And I think it's more than what we know, that what is going on. Why should they run away from Kabul? If they have been in Kabul, the military from all countries that want the freedom in Afghanistan from dictators, why should they run away now? There is also some fishy. It have nothing with the president of United States to do, because there is many countries they are running away now, and they left behind those people that have worked for them. So that's not, I think it's very disturbing. It's very disturbing. I'm not a political person, but I feel for these people that is left behind. Even if they maybe, many of them have counted on some benefits to help United States or help Sweden or whatever country there is in Afghanistan. But they still are human, they are still people. And it's not nice to know that they are coming and kill them. So, there is nothing to do more than God knows what's going on in Afghanistan. It's a very bad country, but it's wrong to run away. But we don't know what it is. It's maybe something very, very dangerous going on, more than Taliban's is very bad. But it may be something else that only the army know. what's going on. And I tell you something more that happened since the last time I recording. I go out, I drive out and I pick fruit and berries from the forest for free. And I sit, it was maybe 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I sit there and I clean up some plumes that I have found. And suddenly, as it was like a crash. It sounds like a crash in the air. And then I, on my left, on my right side, in a chair, it was like someone come and sit down in the chair. And I was thinking, I maybe saw something wrong because I had some jacket there on the chair. But I saw that the jacket was not laying like it could fall down. It was laying safe in the chair, inside the chair. So I felt inside me like I know, I feel now that someone is here. I felt like it was someone sitting on the chair, and then I feel this chill like I do when the spirits are here. But then I'd be very, very sleepy, and I felt me depressed also. So I went to take a nap, but it was usually I take a nap or rest, what you call it, about 4 or 5 in the afternoon, but here it was 2 o'clock, and I should not be sleepy. But I say to her that I'm going to bed now and sleep, and you can talk to me in a dream or something when I fall to sleep. You can come to me in a dream. I say to this person, but then I remember that I can't say like that. I have to involve God in this when I'm talking. I always do that. I talk to God before I start to recording, so He is involved in the recording. So I say to God that let this person spirit say something. Can you allow her to do that, God? I say to Him, and I go and lay down in my bed, and it was very strange that also, but I have got it many times, that in a second it's coming a picture to me. Not that they are not saying anything to me, but I get picture of people. This was just a second before I fall to sleep. It was It was a girl that was about between 10 and 12 years old. And a white person and with blonde hair, long blonde hair. And she threw something on me. It was, you know, it was just when I fall to sleep, just in a second before I fall to sleep. And she was angry at me, and she threw some, I don't know what it was. It was not balls, it was rounded, but I think it was not a ball, because it was not solid. So something else, and maybe is she coming back so she can maybe tell us why she did that to me. Why she was angry at me, what is no, I can't undo it, but we can talk about it and let me know what it is I can, what I have done, so on, not only that threw something on me and not saying anything. And I think I felt like I should recording now, because someone like forcing me to do it. It's not a real force, but I feel like it's time to do a recording and time to listen. If someone from heaven is coming through, and it's this girl, that coming through. She has showing up here sometimes now, and she has coming closer to me, and I have seen in the air, I have seen a swift. It's a swifting in the air. It changed the air in some places here. And I know it's she that's coming, and she is standing now here ready to talk. So I will see why she is angry at me. What's she say that I have not seen her? She have wanted me to do something for her. She say, you didn't realize, she say, you don't really realize how sick I was. And you are a healer, she's saying. And I felt like you ignore me. And I wonder when was it I ignore you? It's she showed me a hospital, inside the hospital. There is bed in a room with beds. And she said, she entered into me now. Remember this. Remember But I was so young. I was so young. How could I know? It was, I was so confusing in that time. It was something I didn't complete with her. It was this way, at the hospital when I was 16 years old. I didn't know so much about, I didn't know God. I didn't know much things. I was confused in that age. And she said that you come and now she's talking about healing again. You come into my room and you took your hand over my head and you make me to could walk again. I was disabled, I couldn't walk and I couldn't talk, and because I had been to a car accident and my parents was killed. And she say, I say, why was it not enough that I did a healing on you so you could walk and you could talk? What was it I could do anything, because I was confused. And it was where I sit and wait for that little girl I had with me to the doctor. And I heard God was talking to me. But you know, I didn't know God. So I was not awake. So I didn't know what it was. And God took me. So I was not myself in this. What could I do for you more than? She mean that I should in some way be there for her when she didn't have her parents. She say that I should come back to the hospital and be with her in that time when she grieve her parents. And she says she had been angry the whole life on me because of that. But have not you got the information from heaven how it was for me? I was not an ordinary girl of 16. I was confused and I was in so many abusive situations in my life. I was not a strong person. And I didn't know God. I didn't go to church, I didn't read the Bible. When I heard God is telling me to go and lay hand on you and heal you, she say that it's like it was sticking to my mind that you never come back. I was waiting for you to come back the whole time. And you never did it. And I said, it's very strange that no one have talked to you about it in heaven, so you know what's going on. I have never done it. It's a weakness I have in my brain. It's hard for me to feel emotional for any person, because I have seen so many evil things in my life. Before I was 16 years old, I was abused so many times. So I cut off the emotional. I can't, still today, I am not crying for a person that have died. I can't do these sort of things, because it's a scar I have from my childhood that I can love people, but I can't go into emotional bad situation like it was for you. I don't know why they have not talking to you in heaven about it. It seems like they want you to talk to me about it. And now she's saying she know the answer, because she said that I should talk to you for a learning. Of course I feel sorry for that you sit and wait for me at the hospital for a long time. And I didn't know. I thought you were... Yeah, and when you were at the hospital, you were in the children's area. And in children's areas in that time, you must be under 16 years old. So when I saw you last... when you threw these things on me, you look like you were 10, 12 years old. But I don't think that you were. Maybe you are 12. Because you must have been under 16 years old when I was in the hospital. And... she said, you know that. You know that we in heaven, we can decide what age we will be. And here is your learning and your reminder that God wants you to have. That's why he sent me. That is, that we in heaven, when we come to heaven, we can decide what age we want to be. And when I come to heaven, my most happiest time was when my parents lived. So I wanted to be in the happy time when my parents lived before the car accident. So I was younger in that time, and then I'd be younger in heaven, because I wanted to be in the best time of my life. And you know that. You know it already, because you have been to heaven and you have find out that in heaven they're gonna give us the best time in our life. And for you it will be in this time, in your age that you are now, because that's your best time you have, is today. And everything in your life have been evil things, and you have been abused so much up to this age. So for you is gonna be that you going to be about 69, 70 years old. But for me, it was best before I got the accident. And you know that even if I could walk, my whole life I had pain in my body. I could walk, but the pain was there the whole time. And you know, because you hold your hand on my head, and you could feel that I have no skull on that side that you hold your hand. So it have been a struggle for me my whole life, and that's when they say, ask in heaven in what age I wanted to be, and I say I want to be in that age when my parents lived, because there is maybe a chance that my parents is the same age when they died in the car accident. So we will be, it's coming very much now. It's very confirming that what she tells us now is right. That I, even if I move on and live for a long time, I was 42 when I went back to heaven. And I met my parents in that same time as the car crash was. So that's why I looked younger for you. And I was not in that age that I was in the hospital. You saw me is like I was under 16, but I was maybe 14, 15 years old. And I've been for a long time in the hospital because of the crash, car crash. So that's what it's gonna be, and we come together. Our family come together in the same time when the crash was. And they kept them in that age for us to be together in completeness in heaven. 'Cause I was the only child for them. And that's why I told you that I had no one. I was by myself. I don't like that you the whole time have you make me be on my own. You have closed door for me. For me to be so lonely as you were when I left you in the hospital. And that's not nice that you have kept me to be on my own. It's it is you that have stopped me from have friends and have a family. It's you that have done that. So, what are you going to do now? Are you going to be the same? That you stop me from everything, that you want me to stay lonely, alone, not have any friends, not have any family, nothing, not have my grandkids. So that's what I was thinking, that you should come through. Not that I knew that this was you at, in the hospital, but I was thinking that that person that come down here and sit in my chair, that this person with that kind of anger you show me, that it should be something positive. I was hoping it should be a positive thing, that you could take away your anger against me when you come here, down here. It's God's mercy on you, because I have some time left here on earth, and so there is, it's still time to repair what you have done. There is time you can repair what you have done to me. I knew it was some curses on me. I know that, because I have seen that everything have, I thought good things should come to me, and many things I could see it coming to me, good, real nice things, and then it was like stopped. It never come. Many promises people have done, suddenly it was not there. People avoid me, and that's you that have stopped people to come and be my friends and have nice things together. So you can, if you are not careful, God can place you in hell. If you do these things I say to you, I don't say you should be, but you can be like that, that you will be departed from heaven. But there is time for you to repair the damage you had done for me in my life. I'm still here on earth, so there is time yet for you to do good things in my life, to help me and help God to spread the message. Those things I recording, everything that I have recorded in my podcast, it's God's podcast, it's Jesus Christ's podcast, it's Heaven's podcast, it's God's Kingdom's podcast. And you can do so much things to help us, to help me to could spread the podcast to the whole world, for the whole world to understand what's going on, that they understand that I talk to heaven, understand that Jesus Christ is coming down sometimes, understand that the Holy Mary is coming down here, and a special that God is coming down and talk to me. It's you. I find the answer. I'm so happy that I find the answer. Cursing me. And you have cursing me for a long time. And it's time for you to stop. Because it's... I see. It's like Jesus when he went into the temple and clean up those market place inside the temple. When he say that it should be a house for prayer in God's house, should it be? And he means it should be peace. It should be a prayer and peace. And you have to make peace with your state of mind that you have. You need to stop what you are doing. That's it. I don't want to see you like that. I think I share the picture that I have in me together with you, how you be swept away from to be to in heaven. You're gonna be separated from your parents, and that will not be joyful for them when you're leaving, but God will tell them why, and they understand your parents why, because you can't hold back my life only because I did something that you didn't like when we were young teens. That's so bad. That's very bad. So if you want to have real peace, you have to make peace with me and understand that I couldn't do anything. It was hard for me to feel anything for you when you sit there, even if I heard that you were on your own. It's coming again. That is like everything is on me. In everything in my life. And that's you also that have done it. That everything is on me when the doctors say they can't help me because there is other that need help more than me, like that. That you have taken away so much other things in my life. So we heard you now. You have had your moment now. And I don't want you to come back. Because you need to have peace in yourself. And leave me alone now. And don't stop me anymore. Don't stop my life. Don't make that the doctor. I'm going now in 4 days. I'm going to a doctor. And he is going to tell me what they find inside my body. What they find in my pancreas. And if he say that I have cancer in my pancreas, then I know it's you that have done that. That's you. Because you want to stop me. So you are so very wrong, but God has made this time for you to come, because you should teach me also, so he spare you. because of that. And but he maybe not spare you if you don't change your mind and repair what you have done to me. So, oh yeah. That was interesting. It's amazing that answer I got now, that I know what it was so far. Far away, it's 50 years. And it have been, in all these 50 years, it have been wrong things happened to me the whole time. So that's interesting to come to know the curse, where they come from. We will see if things happen, good things happen now, that it should have been for 50 years. And like I say, I'm going to the doctor. Next time I'm recording, I know what the doctor have said. They have done a MRI scan on me. They have scanned my body, and they scan my organs, and they scan a special pancreas. And they have told me that they have seen something in my pancreas that make a big hole in the pancreas, and that make me be sick. Almost my whole life have I been sick, and it have been so very hard, because people, doctors and people have said that I'm so fat. And it was only one doctor that said that to me, that it's not your fault. He knew what's going on with pancreas. If the pancreas is sick, ill, like mine is, then it doesn't digest the food you get. I eat so very, very little, and I don't eat any. But not every day I eat some sweet candies like that. And now when I have diabetes, I try to not eat sugar. So, I don't lose any weight. But that's like the doctor say, it's not my fault, because the pancreas does it. And so I will see what's going on Wednesday now, if you listen just now. It's the 18, August 18, 2021, I know what's going on inside my body. And I am not going to feel sorry if the doctor say I am going to die, because we all is going to die anyway. So as he say, die, that's what they say here on earth. But I don't die, and I have been to heaven many times, so I know where I'm going, so I'm not scared at all. And I think it will be relaxing to know if it was so. But I hope it will be a surgery that they do a surgery on my pancreas, because I know, I don't know, but I think it's gallstone, because I had that in the 80s, very, very much gallstone attack, so much, so I have to go first in line and do a surgery very fast, emergency. And when I wake up from the surgery, the doctor say that I couldn't go in and x-ray inside me if there was were any gallstone in those pipes between the liver and pancreas and this. And she shake her head and laugh at me and say that it never is any gallstone in that is inside a person when we are taken away the gallstone, she say. But it was in mine. It's very strange that she say that and they fail to go in. That I know that that's the devil that stop them from going and look at it. But I think that in that time, in the 80s, I think they couldn't do anything. There is more chance that they can succeed to take out the gallstone in my pancreas today than it was in the 80s. So it's God's timing, everything. So I hope I got that from the doctor that they're going to help me by they go in and take a piece, that piece of the pancreas that the gallstone is laying in it. They can take it out very easily with a, I don't know what it's called, but this pipe they do in this television program when they take the stomach out from fat people like that. It's only a hole they go in and it do it. So, but pancreas is a dangerous place to be in. So that's a risky surgery anyway. But it's like I say that I have been to heaven many times and I know how it looked like in heaven. So I am not frightened. The only thing I'm frightened about that is painful before I die. That's the only. So thank you for have listened. It was very special with that girl that's coming. So I didn't know what her name, she never say her name. In the hospital and not here either. She say, it sounds like she's saying Teresa or something like that. So thank you for listening. And God loves you, you know, and I love you too. I'm so thankful that you listen and thankful for all my followers. Thank you.